Welcome to City Church of Dallas. It is so powerful what God is doing here. So just tune in, open up your heart, let the music open up your heart. Worship right where you are with us in your hotel room or in your office or in your home, and let God touch your life. Let the word go deep inside of your heart. Words are seeds. Let them produce a harvest. Let them be planted in the soil of your heart, and let God do a great work in you. I'm so excited that you are here with us for this broadcast. I believe God will change your life.
Something's changing. Sees glory. Feel the lightning and thunder. Where is lightning and thunder? Miracles and wonders. The sound of many waters. Heaven on earth. Where is lightning and thunder? Miracles and wonders. The sound of many waters. Heaven on earth. There is lightning and thunder. Miracles and wonders. Many waters, heaven on earth, there is lightning and thunder, miracles and wonders, sound of many waters, heaven on earth. Oh, oh, oh. Heaven, heaven on earth. Oh, oh, oh.
No place I would rather be.
No,
no place I. The Spirit of the Lord is searching the earth, Scripture says, to find somebody who will worship Him in spirit and in truth. Here I am.
Yeah. in your the amazing, powerful things that come out of ordinary things. The bread represents the body of Christ. And it represents something more than even we can think of. See, communion has always been something that they've done. And they did before Jesus made it a tradition in our lives. And they do it today. Because when you break bread with each other, that's when you get to know each other. When you eat dinner with each other, when you know each other, that is when you become family, a church family.
That's good.
A relationship with other Christians. The blood, the body of Christ, was important, and this is what this represented to Jesus. And that body held the blood that we talk about all the time. We don't talk about the body much, we talk about the blood a lot. That body held it. And it had to be beaten and broken in order for that blood to be spilled, in order for us to be set free. His gift of immense pain, of sorrow.
Thank you.
sin in my life. Colossians 3, 17 and 23. Sorry we don't have screens for you yet, but we have to do it the old-fashioned way and actually open up the book. Colossians 3, 17 and 23. In the 1972 Olympics, Kathy Rigby was a gymnast, and she did her very best, in the competition, but her scores did not put her in first place. And Kathy was a believer, and her mom was a strong believer, and she came back to her mom, and she said, "Mom, I did my best." She said, "Honey, that's all you can do. You know you did your best. I know you did your best. And God knows you did your best." And I think in this world that we are in, and in the church environment that many of us have come from, there is an expectancy, and there is a competitive thing in the air to make us keep up with that one, or keep up with this one, or make the income of this one, or have the church the size of that one, or have the music department do this or that, or have a giant singing Christmas tree, or whatever it might be. And all that is great. But I want to encourage you today that God is not putting a requirement on you to be something like anybody else. There's no one like you in all the earth. There's no one like me in all the earth. Before church, before rehearsal today, we did a songwriting, I think there were about 12 or 13 of us in here, where I was teaching our team songwriting. You know what? Bishop Jakes is awesome. He's brought a delivering word to everybody. But he didn't write his songs. God's blessed me to help write some of those songs. He can't teach his people how to write a song. But I'm a pastor who can teach our people how to write a song. Jack Graham, with a big giant orchestra and 500 voice choir up in Plano, they're amazing. What they do is awesome. But I don't compare my pastoring to his, or to First Baptist Downtown, or to Fellowship Church, or to Joel Osteen, or to anybody in this world. I don't have to compete with anybody, but I do have a call of God on my life to do the best that I can do, and be the best that I can be. And it is not something that we need to wear like chains of bondage around us, but it is something that we can esteem to understand how great God is within us and how great we can be. You are made in the image and the likeness of God. We need to remember we are made in the image and likeness of God. The serpent told Eve, "If you partake of this fruit, you will be like the Most High God." Well, I want to let you know today, the lie is you can be. The truth is you already are. Whoa! Every human being, and we have this thing in our head that we've been taught in fundamentalism and in evangelical churches that no one has any value or worth or any goodness in them until they say the right prayer at the altar after the preacher, or until they're baptized the right way, until they become a new creation and born again. There's no worth or no good in them. And I want to tell you, that is not true. Every human being is made in the image and the likeness of God, has God's DNA.
Yes.
Now, when you are filled with the Spirit of God and born again, then you are a container of God's glory. You are the light of the world, a city on a hill that cannot be hidden, a new creation. Amen. And I want to get back to the foundation of what this church is on this first Sunday. The scripture in Matthew that says, you are the light of the world, a city on a hill that cannot be hidden. That is our theme scripture at City Church. We are the light of the world. The scripture says that Jesus was the light of the world, but then he said, you are the light of the world. Paul said, have the same mind in you that was in Christ Jesus, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God. So I want to today remind you of who you are in God. You are not the creator. You are the created. You are God's child. But I want to tell you, if we can understand Jesus, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God, took upon human flesh and the shame of the cross, because he's done this, he has been given a name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue confess. Well, that scripture tells us to have that same mind in us right there. That's the scripture that says it, that was in Christ Jesus, who thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but humbled himself. If the same Spirit, that raised Christ from the dead dwells in you, it will make alive, quicken your mortal body. The scripture says the fullness of the Godhead was in Jesus bodily. I'm about to talk about Abraham in a minute. When Abraham at Mount Moriah found Jehovah Jireh, his provider, that same Spirit was fully on the inside of Jesus Christ. When Jesus walked into the room, Jehovah Jireh walked in. Jehovah Rapha, the healer from the Old Testament, walked in. If the same Spirit dwells in me that raised Christ from the dead, it'll quicken your mortal body, my mortal body. When I walk into the room, Jehovah Jireh, your provider, walks into the room, because Jehovah Jireh is on the inside of me. And until we can recognize and understand who we are in God, we are the light of the world. Jesus did not come to condemn the world in John 3:17, but he came that the world might be saved. And I want to encourage you, we are Jesus' ambassadors and representatives in this world. And if we begin to condemn people who don't know God, then we are not of the Spirit of Christ. We are anti-Christ. But I want to encourage you today, who you are. You have not come into this world to condemn the world, but that the world through Jesus Christ might be saved. Is there a witness in this place? Hallelujah! Glory! We need a wake-up call to remember who we are. And if we are always having the mindset that we are some poor, sorry sinner, then we're missing the point. We are in a world, a church world of penance and paying for our sins. Or you'll answer for every word you'll say. Or you'll do this. You'll answer for every wrong thing you do. If I stand before the judge at judgment day, here's what I plead. I plead the blood of Jesus. Hallelujah. And the worst of us stand clean before God. And it's not by my works or your works or your conduct or the way. No, it's by the grace of God, by faith in God's grace. Is there a witness in this place? And it's a finished work. It is done. Hallelujah. It is finished. So when we understand who we are in God, we can shine brightly like God wants us to. Like we can really heal people where they are and really help people where they are. That's why we are here, not to condemn, but to save people. And it's the work's already been done for eternity. It's a finished deal. But we're here to illuminate the darkness in people's lives. People are in such dark places. How many as a believer have ever been in a dark place? I have been. That's when we need a wake-up call to remember who we are. We are the light of the world. We are the salt of the earth. We are God's expression in the earth. We are God's hands, God's feet. We are God's words in this earth. Hallelujah. So I want us to make a choice and make a decision to do our very best. Colossians 3:17. And we have to understand, it's not on a demerit and merit system while we do our best. We do our best because we are ambassadors. We represent God. That's why we do our best. Not to win brownie points with God, because you already did. He loves you so much, completely. God cannot ever love you any more than God already loves you. Your sins cannot be paid for any more than they are already paid for. You cannot be any more righteous and holy before God than you are right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, for mercy. Thank you for grace. Thank you for the blood that sets us free and saves us, not because of anything I've done, but because of everything you've done. Not because of who I am, where I've been, what I've done, but because of who you are, where you've been, what you've done. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Is there a gratitude in this place? Is there thankfulness in this place? Glory to God. We're so grateful, God. We're so thankful. Thank you, God. So it's not a merit system how God blesses us. In fact, we're going to come back to Colossians. Let's just go to Genesis 20. So I went to the first book of the Bible, Genesis, and because it's the first Sunday of the year, right? And what is the year? 2016? Yes. Well, let's go to that first book of the Bible and go to 2016. And just so you know, I went to every 2016 from Genesis to Revelation. And I found my two favorites. Okay, so let me catch you up what happened right before here. So, in the mindset of Abraham, he had just seen Sodom and Gomorrah destroyed. And it might not be for how you think, how we've been taught, but Scripture says it was destroyed for their inhospitality. They were cruel. They were mean. They were rapist and horrible people. So God said, I'll just go ahead and bring you on to eternity now because you're just messing up the world. Just kind of brought them into eternity. You know, the blood of Jesus is retroactive. David is saved by the blood of Jesus. Abraham is saved by the blood of Jesus. Adam and Eve, Daniel, saved by the blood of Jesus. It's retroactive. The mercy of God didn't start when Jesus said it is finished. God has always been merciful. God has always had grace. Jesus was a perfect representation of the goodness and the mercy of God and the grace of God and the love of God. God is good. Is there a witness in this place? So Sodom and Gomorrah had just been burned up and there was smoke rising. And Abraham had come into a city, into a land, and he was afraid. And, oh, by the way, and God had just promised Abraham at 99 years old that he was going to have a son. And his dried up old 90-year-old wife, God said the same thing about her, that she was going to have a child.
Amen.
That's right. Sounds impossible, doesn't it?
Yeah.
With man, these things are impossible, but with God, all things are possible. So be encouraged. So that had all just happened. Sarah laughed at God that God would do that through, and the prophet told her. She just laughed at God, said there's no way that can happen. And all that had just happened, and then Abraham and Sarah were getting ready to go. They were coming into this land, into this city, and the king of that place, and all the men that were there, Sarah was so beautiful that Abraham was afraid they would kill him and take Sarah to be their wife. So he devised a plan. He said, we're going to lie like a rug. I'm paraphrasing. He said, Sarah, we're going to lie, and you're my sister. And she said, all right. So he told them all, the king and everybody, that that was his sister. Well, in a dream, I forgot the king's name, it's in there. In a dream, I read it, the king, God told the king that Sarah was Abraham's wife and not his sister. And so, and God told him that he was going to kill the king because he took Sarah and he was about to celebrate. And so God told him that, and he ran and he told Abraham, why did you lie to me? This is not your sister, it's your wife, and the curse of God is going to be on me because I was about to defile her. True. So that's when we come to Genesis 20:16. Say, Abraham lied. He was afraid. He was operating in fear. It was Abimelech. And said unto Sarah, Abimelech said unto Sarah, he said, behold, I have given thy brother, Abraham, and he knew it was her husband, 1,000 pieces of silver. That is a lot of money. Behold, he is to thee a covering of the eyes unto all that are with thee and with all other. Thus she was reproved. So what did Abraham see? That he did not have to pay for the wrong that he had done. But even though he had made a mistake, even though he had failed the heart of God and lied and was afraid, and the father of faith was not operating in faith. Have you made a mistake today? Have you been operating in fear? Have you not been operating in faith? Have you committed any wrong or committed any sin? Are you thinking that you are not a candidate to be blessed by God? That you not are not qualified or not set apart for the favor of God and the blessing of God? I want to encourage you today. The grace of God is just not about your eternal salvation, but the grace of God is a alive every day. The Bible said his mercies are new every morning, and the same grace that saves you is the same grace that makes you qualified, no matter where you've been, no matter what you've done, for the blessing and favor of God. Is there a witness in this place? Amen. Well, that doesn't add up. That's not how I was raised. That's not how I was raised either, but it's true. We'll go to another 20:16. Is that all right? Matthew, the first book of the New Testament, 20:16. I want to encourage you today, no matter what you've done, God still wants to bless you. God still wants to touch your life. God still wants to shine His glory in His light on you. God still wants to raise you up and restore you. When God restores, it's better than before. The word restore means the establishment of something new that is greater than what was before. We serve a God of a restoration. We serve a good God who blesses His children. Amen?
Amen.
Matthew 20. 20 what? 2016. So Jesus was telling the parable of how this, let's call him this owner of a business, went and he hired people at 9 a.m., then hired people at noon, then 3, then 5. And at the very end, he told the guy that was paying everybody, he said, start with the people that I just hired at the end of the day and pay them this amount, and then the one that I hired at 3, and then go all the way back to the ones I hired at 9 a.m. and give them the same amount of the one that I gave at 5. Well, the guy did it. And did you know that everybody was so angry? The people that had been working since 9 a.m. were so angry that the people that just got hired at 5 p.m. got the same blessing as the one that started at 9. So I want to tell you, in 2016, in 2016, I want to express to you how wonderful the grace of God, the unmerited favor of God is for your life, even though you may not deserve it. What does Matthew 20:16 say? So the last shall be first, and the first last, for many God called. I want to encourage you today that no matter what you've done in 2015 that would make you feel not acceptable to God, nothing you do can separate you from the love of God. It's a new day. It's a new year. And no matter if you're just coming in to alignment with God's plan and God's will, I want to encourage you. God is going to bless you still. The last shall be first. Is there a witness in this place? So that's one thing I wanted to say. We do not operate on a demerit system with God. We operate in the dispensation of grace. That's where we live. And God is a God full of grace. We reap what we sow. But God has a way of taking the years that the canker worm ate and bringing restoration into our life. And all those wasted years, God can make it up in a minute.
Yes.
Glory. Colossians 3:17. Galatians, Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians. There you go. Our kids need Sunday school, don't they? So they can learn all those things. 3:17. And whatsoever, that was the first part of what I wanted to say. Now I'm getting ready in 5 minutes to be done, but I want to tell you this, the second part of what I wanted to end on this today and to tell you. On whatsoever you do in word or deed, say anything I do,
anything I do
all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. Okay, and let's go to verse 23 for our last scripture before I read you one more thing. And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as to the Lord and not unto people. That word heartily means soulfully. That means from your heart. That means from your soul. It means to do exceedingly abundantly more. It means to do your best. So whatever you do this year in 2016, remember who you represent. Do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And do your best. I make a pledge to you today that I'm going to up my game. I don't look at the back past with regret and say I shoulda, coulda, woulda. Because if God would have told me to do something, I would have done it no matter what. I want to obey God. But you know, I'm sure, I know I've made mistakes. But I want to do the best that I know now and take from those years where I may have made mistakes. And I want to be the best that I can be with the wisdom that I have obtained through the failures and experiences and the victories that I've come through. Amen? Miss B is right here. I'm going to ask you to do something. It's 6:03. We're going to be done soon. I'm going to ask you to do something. And I want to talk to you about something. Bob, B's husband, you know, this thing's up here, the guy with the goatee, the gray and the gray hair, kind of sings bass on this end. You know what I'm talking about. Bob and B are a precious part of the City Church family. And Bob had a famous dad in broadcasting, right? And he had a brother who has a story about him in the Reader's Digest. And we're going to bring everybody a copy of this maybe next week or the week after. A story in the Reader's Digest that is the most read story in the history of Reader's Digest. And Bob's brother, two movies have been made about him, including one by CBS. And there is such a powerful story, and I can't tell it as well as it is written. And I want you, I don't do anything like this, I've never done anything like this, but I want to read to you for a minute. Is that all right? About someone that's connected to this house. Bob Baker and B. Baker's brother-in-law is John Baker. This is B. Waved everybody. Okay, you ready? Now, I want you to not fall asleep or think about your grocery list. I want you to hear this. I've never done anything like this. I've never read to you anything like this. The future looked bright to a 24-year-old John Baker in the spring of 1969. At the peak of an astonishing athletic career, touted by sports writers as one of the fastest milers in the world, he had fixed his dreams on representing the United States in the 1972 Olympic Games. By the way, I'm warning you right now, I so far have not been able to get through this without crying. I'm going to try to. Nothing in Baker's early years had hinted at such prominence. Slight of build and inches shorter than most of his teenage Albuquerque pals, he was considered too uncoordinated. Does anybody have readers? A little strong. All right. Sorry. There we go. Yes, thank you, God. All right. I wear an extra large hat, so if I stretch these out, I apologize. He's too uncoordinated to run track in high school, but something happened during his junior year that changed the course of his life. For some time, the Manzano High track coach, Bill Wolforth, had been trying to induce a tall, promising runner named John Haland, who was Baker's best friend, to join the track team. Ready, listen? Haland refused. "Let me join the team," Baker suggested one day. "Then Haland might too." Wolforth agreed, and the maneuver worked, and John Baker had become a runner. Surge of energy. The first meet that year, it was 1960, was a 1.7-mile cross-country race through the foothills east of Albuquerque. Most eyes were focused on Albuquerque's reigning state cross-country champion, Lloyd Goff. Immediately after the crack of the gun, the field lined up as expected, with Goff setting the pace and Haland on his heels. At the end of 4 minutes, the runners disappeared one by one behind a low hill inside the far turn of the course. A minute passed, two, then a lone figure appeared. Coach Wolforth nudged an assistant. "Here comes Goff." Then he raised his binoculars. "Good grief!" he yelled. "That's not Goff, it's Baker." Leading a field of stalwart runners far behind, Baker crossed the finish line. His time, 8:03, set a new meet record. What had happened on the far side of that hill, Baker later explained. Halfway through the race, running well back of the leaders, he had asked himself a question. Am I doing my best? He didn't know. Fixing his eye on the back of the runner immediately in front of him, he closed his mind to all else. Only one thing mattered: catch and pass that runner, and then go after the next one. An unknown reserve of energy surged through his body. It was almost hypnotic, Baker recalled. One by one, he passed the other runners, ignoring the fatigue that tore at his muscles. He maintained his furious pace until he crossed the finish line and collapsed in exhaustion. Had the race been a fluke? As the season progressed, Wolfarth entered Baker in a number of other events, and always the result was the same. Once on the track, the modest, fun-loving teenager became a fierce, unrelenting competitor, a heart runner. The Bible says that we need to do it with all of our soul, our heart, to do our best. Amen? A heart runner who simply wouldn't be beat. By the end of his junior year, Baker had broken 6 state track records. And during his senior year, he was proclaimed the finest miler ever developed in the state. He was not yet 18. Upset John. In the fall of 1962, Baker entered the University of New Mexico in Albuquerque and stepped up his training. Each morning at dawn, spray can in hand to ward off snapping dogs, he ran through city streets, parks, and golf courses 25 miles a day, all in addition to daily varsity workouts. The training told. Soon in Abilene, Tulsa, State, Salt Lake City, wherever the New Mexico Lobos competed, Upset John Baker was confounding forecasters by picking off favored runners. In the spring of 1965, when Baker was a junior, the most feared track team in the nation belonged to the University of Southern California. Those haughty California people. So when the mighty Trojans descended on Albuquerque for a dual meet, sportscasters predicted doom for the Lobos. The mile, they said, would fall to USC's Big Three: Chris Johnson, Doug Calhoun, and Bruce Bess, in that order. All had better times for the mile than Baker. Baker led for one lap, then eased purposely back to fourth position, rattled Calhoun, and Bess moved uneasily into the forfeited lead. Johnson, wary, held back. In the far turn of the third lap, at the same moment, Baker and Johnson moved for the lead and collided. Fighting to stay on his feet, Baker lost precious yards, and Johnson moved into the lead. With 330 yards to go, Baker kicked into his final sprint. First Bess, then Calhoun fell back. On the final turn, it was Johnson and Baker neck and neck. Slowly, Baker inched ahead. With both hands above his head in a V for victory sign, he broke the tape, a winner by 3 seconds. Inspired by Baker's triumph, the Lobos swept every following event, handing the demoralized Trojans their third worst defeat in 65 years. Pride cometh before a fall. I'm 2/3 through. A coach who cared. Upon graduation, Baker considered his options. There were college coaching offers, but he had always planned to work with children. There was also his running. Was he wondered, Olympic material? In the end, he accepted a job that would allow him to pursue both ambitions. He became a coach at Aspen Elementary School in Albuquerque, and at the same time renewed his rigorous training with an eye to the 1972 games. At Aspen, another facet of Baker's character emerged. At the elementary school, he was a coach. On his playing fields, there were no stars and no criticism for lack of ability. His only demand was that each child do his or her best. This fairness, plus an obviously sincere concern for his students' welfare, triggered a powerful response. Youthful grievances were brought first to Coach Baker, real or fancied, each one treated as if at the moment it was the most important matter in the world, and the word spread, Coach cares. Early in May 1969, shortly before his 25th birthday, Baker noticed that he was tiring prematurely during workouts. 2 weeks later, he developed chest pains, and one morning near the end of the month, he awoke with a painfully swollen groin. He made an appointment to see a doctor. The urologist, Edward Johnson, said Baker's symptoms were ominous, requiring immediate exploratory surgery. The operation confirmed Johnson's fears, cancer. Though Dr. Johnson didn't say it, he estimated that even with a second operation, Baker had approximately 6 months to live. At home, recuperating for the second operation, Baker confronted the grim reality of his world. There would be no more running and no Olympics. Almost certainly his coaching career was ended. Worst of all, his family faced months of anguish. Edge of the precipice. On the Sunday before the second operation, Baker left home for a drive in the mountains. He was gone for hours. At a return that evening, there was a marked change in his spirits. His habitual smile, of late only a mask, was again natural and sincere. What's more, for the first time in 2 weeks, he spoke of future plans. Late that night, he told his sister Jill what had happened that clear June day. He had driven to Sandia Crest, the majestic 2-mile-high mountain peak that dominates Albuquerque. I'm just read it. He was going to take his life. And then he thought how horrible those students would feel and the pain his family would have, and he decided not to. Whatever time I have left, he told himself, I'm dedicated to the kids. In September, following extensive abdominal surgery and a summer of cobalt treatments, Baker reimmersed himself in his job. And to his already full schedule, he added a new commitment, sports for the handicapped. Whatever their infirmity, children who had once stood idle on the sidelines now assume positions as coach's timekeeper, or chief equipment watcher, or foul line supervisor, all wearing the official Aspen jerseys, all eligible to earn a Coach Baker ribbon for trying hard. Baker made the ribbons himself at home in the evening from material purchased with his own money. Silent suffering. By Thanksgiving, letters in praise of Baker from grateful parents were arriving almost daily at Aspen. More than 500 would be received before a year had passed. My son was a morning monster, one mother wrote. Getting him up, fed, and out the door. We know how that is with Dee Dee right here. I mean, a morning monster. She really is. She's not a morning person. Getting him up, fed, and out the door was hardly bearable. Now he can't wait for school. He's the chief infield raker. Despite my son's assertions, I could not believe that there was a Superman at Aspen, wrote another mother. I drove over secretly to watch Coach Baker with the children. My son was right. And this from two grandparents. In other schools, our granddaughter suffered terribly from her awkwardness. Then this wonderful year at Aspen, Coach Baker gave her an A for trying her best. God bless this young man who gave a timid child self-respect. In December, during a routine visit to Dr. Johnson, Baker complained of a sore throat and headaches. Tests confirmed that the malignancy had spread to his neck and brain. For 4 months, Johnson now recognized Baker had been suffering severe pain in silence, using his incredible power of concentration to ignore the pain, just as he had used it to ignore fatigue when he ran. Johnson suggested painkiller injections. Baker said no. I want to work with the kids as long as I'm able. The injections would dull my responsiveness. From that moment, Johnson later remarked, I looked upon John Baker as one of the most unselfish persons I've ever known. The last section, Cups for Dashers. Early in 1970, Baker was asked to help coach a small Albuquerque track club for girls from elementary through high school age. Its name, the Duke City Dashers. He agreed on the spot, and like the children of Aspen, the girls on the Dashers responded to the new coach with enthusiasm. One day, Baker arrived at a practice session carrying a shoebox. He announced that it held two awards, one for the fleetest runner and one for the girl who, though never a winner, wouldn't quit. When Baker opened the box, the girls gasped. Inside were two shiny gold trophy cups. From then on, deserving dashers received such cups. Months later, Baker's family would discover that the trophies were his from his racing days in his own name, carefully burnished away. By summer, the Duke City Dashers were a club to contend with, breaking school record after record at meets throughout New Mexico and bordering states. Proudly, Baker made a bold prediction. The Dashers are going to the national AAU finals. But now a new problem plagued Baker. His cobalt treatments had frequent chemotherapy injections, brought on severe nausea, and he could not keep food down. Despite steadily decreasing stamina, however, he continued to supervise the Dashers, usually sitting on a small hill above the training area, hollering encouragement. One afternoon in October, following a huddle on the track below, one of the girls ran up the hill toward Baker. "Hey, coach," she shouted, "your predictions come true. We're invited to the AAU finals in St. Louis next month." Elated, Baker confided to friends that he had one remaining hope to live long enough to go along. But it was not to be. On the morning of October 28th, at Aspen, Baker suddenly clutched his abdomen and collapsed on the playground. Examination revealed that the spreading tumor had ruptured, triggering shock. Declining hospitalization, Baker insisted on returning to school for one last day. He told his parents that he wanted the children to remember him walking tall, not lying helpless in the dirt. Sustained by massive blood transfusions and sedation, Baker realized that for him, the St. Louis trip was impossible. Well, the girls went on to win that meet, and he passed away. That would be the end of the John Baker story, except for a phenomenon which occurred after his funeral. A few of the children of Aspen Elementary began calling their school John Baker School, and the change of name spread like wildfire. Then a movement began to make the new name official. "It's our school," the kids said, "and we want to call it John Baker." Aspen officials referred the matter to the Albuquerque School Board, and the board suggested a voter referendum. In early spring of 1971, 520 families in the Aspen district voted on the question. There were 520 votes for and none against. That May, in a ceremony attended by hundreds of Baker's friends and all of his children, Aspen School officially became John Baker Elementary. It stands today as a visible monument to a courageous young man who, in his darkest hours, transformed bitter tragedy into an enduring legacy. And that man's brother is a part of our ministry team here, and there's his sister-in-law right there. What that does for me, what that did for me, is it made me really ask myself the honest question, am I doing my best? Not someone else's best. I remember I got a message today from a woman in a different country, I think. And she said that she was watching a video that I did 10 years ago with some of the music video I did with some of the pioneers of contemporary Christian music. And she said how much it blessed her. And I remember looking back at that event 10 years ago, it was in San Antonio, thousands had gathered. And I was the only new one that wasn't one of the old pioneers. And I remember overhearing two people make fun of my singing and make fun of me. And the next week, I heard three other singers make fun of me, three guy singers. You might know them. They're well known. And I heard them saying something about my singing. Something bad. And then there was a famous vocalist who's awesome at this table with her product, and those three guys are right there, and here I am, not very well known. And I remember hearing them say that they did 450 in sales, and I remember her saying she did 150, and me, who couldn't sing nearly as good as any of them, did $2,000 in CD sales. So I thought, well, I guess somebody liked it. I couldn't sing as well as any of them, but I could connect to people when I sang. I was a songwriter, so I could minister the lyric that I wrote that was different than them. just different. And I've learned through my own insecurities as a pastor, as a singer, as a person, as a dad, as a son, I've learned in my own life to be the best that I can be, not compared to anybody else. And I want you to know there is greater strength. There is a reserve of energy on the inside of you that is greater than you can ever imagine. And I want you to make the pledge. I'm going to make the pledge at City Church as pastor to do my very best. I've not done my very best in some areas. I could blame it on this and blame it on that and blame it on this. But I am resolved in my mind to do my best. But I have to have you help me. So I want you to do your best. There are about 150 people call this church home. But we might have 75 or 80 here today. Not everybody is always here. But about 150 call it home. To me, if I were not the pastor, when I was a church attender, to me, my best, I'm not pointing my finger to anybody, you do your best. This is my best. My best was being at church. Unless I was sick, or working, or out of town. My best for my home church was tithing, giving God his 10% off the top when I was a part of a church. That was my best. And to be there and to plug in some ministry in that church where I could help. I promise you, I will do my best. And wherever you are, wherever you live, be the best where you are. Be the best at your church. The best, not from other people, your best. Do your best at your job. If you're coming in 8 minutes late every day and it's a habit, this is the time of the year to break that habit and begin to be 8 minutes early. You can do that. Being 8 minutes late every day is not your best. It's not your best. If you make, we have 23 tithers at City Church, and five of them don't live here. So if you're making $40,000 a year and you're giving $25 to God when you go to church, that's not your best. There's some people here that are people of hope that are currently out of work. Listen, the tithe is not just for people who have a big income. The tithe is for believers. For everybody that wants to be in covenant with God. So if you make $500 a month, off the top, prove God and give God, wherever your church is, prove God and give God his tithe in your offering. Be present in your church family. Did anybody bring food for Penny and Catherine? You ate most of it. I see bags of food. We got our dear Penny right here. Her mom passed away just a couple of days ago. Miss Modine has been in this church. What a great, great, great woman. 87 years old, has been suffering. But our dear Penny right here, and Catherine, Penny lost her mom. So we want to be a good church family. I know Angie, I was out of town. Angie was there when she passed. And we've got some food here for you, for your home. And we've been praying our guts out for you, sweetheart. We love you so much. Everybody stretch your hand toward Penny. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, Dee Dee and Dee Dee. Stretch your hand. Penny, we just pray the comfort of the Lord over your life. Jesus said, I will send a comforter to comfort you. I speak the comfort of the Spirit of God over your mind, over your relationships, over your family, over your home. I just speak provision in every way. I speak the favor of God and the light of God to illuminate any dark place in this situation. I speak hope where there's been a feeling of hopelessness. I speak faith where there's been fear. I just speak the peace of God to this storm in your life. From this moment forward, there would be divine peace that passes all understanding in the name of Jesus. And I pray for Catherine right now. I speak the blessing of the Lord. Oh, and the favor of God over your life, Catherine. Things are about to change. You're about to step into a new season. Hallelujah. A season of favor, a season of blessing. I speak this and decree this over your life. And I decree what the promise of God is over you. That matters more than what any other words are. But what God says, oh, I decree it over your life in Jesus' name. I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord. They're to prosper you. They're for a future and a hope and not to harm you. I speak these blessings over your life in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. If you're in this place today, thank you for staying long. Thank you for letting me preach longer than I've preached in forever. If you are in this place today and you're not serving God, but you want to give your life to God, you just want to give God your best, and you've not turned your life over to the Lord. Scripture says if you believe in your heart that Jesus was raised from the dead and confess him with your mouth, Scripture says you're saved. Jesus paid that price. It's a done deal. If you want to give your life to God today, lift up your hand so I can see it. Yes, 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 yes. Everybody in this place and everybody watching, say, Lord, I give you my life. For the rest of my life, I am yours. Jesus, I believe you are the Son of God, died for me, rose again. You're alive. Lord, let your spirit come into my body and use me to help others. In Jesus' name. Well, I think we do a real good job at City Church with our music. Do you think it's great? I think it's great. I think we do a great job with our music. I think we do a great job with Hope for the Homeless. And the homeless ministry and the bus ministry, I think it's great. I think it's wonderful. I think everybody does a great job. I think we do such a great job with our media ministry, Alex and Steve and all that happens with that. We're probably approaching 900,000 viewers. Is that about right? I know probably a year ago we passed 800,000. So I'm so thankful for all. We've had three different continents contact us this week. Isn't that amazing? Hallelujah. So it's time to sow. It's time to give the first offering, the first tithe of 2016. If you need an envelope, lift up your hand. To give on credit card, a debit card, or you want to give cash, lift up your hand. If you're writing a check, make it to City Church, CITICHURCH of Dallas. If you're giving online, just go to citychurchofdallas.com and go to donate, and you can give securely on PayPal. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for giving. Thank you for sowing. I'm going to pray a blessing over you in a minute, so don't leave. I love you. God bless you. Remember, do your best.
Thank you so much for watching this web broadcast of City Church of Dallas. God is doing so many things. It's blowing my mind. I thought we would be a local church, but we've become an international church through the internet. So what I want you to do, we have people in Iowa, people in Michigan, people all over this country that are sending in support. And because our church is bigger than this room that we're in, and you can feel the actual presence of God, and you are ministered to right over the internet. So if God should lay it on your heart, I want to encourage you to tithe. If you don't have a home church, if you have a home church, tithe there. If you don't, send your tithe in here to City Church of Dallas. Go to City Church of Dallas. This is how you spell it. .com. You can pay on PayPal there, a secure website, or you can send into the address or call in your gift. I promise you, lives are being changed through our prison ministry, nursing home ministry, our AIDS ministry. We feed the hungry, and God is really doing something special. But we're only a little bit more than a year old, so we need people to give. God bless you. I appreciate it with all of my heart.